last Martin Lenz from Groningen, for the first time speaking at the History and Philosophy of Science seminar on Spinoza on the division of cognitive labor. Martin, you have the floor.
Well, thank you very much for having me. At last, you say, rightly, because right is a few times and always something gets in the way. But yeah, I'm very glad to be here, and I've had a wonderful welcome so far, and I hope I won't spoil it by giving a bad paper. So this is part of a larger project, a book project. I want to write a book on intersubjectivity in early modern philosophy. I don't really want it. I'm doing it right now, and the Spinoza chapter is sort of the first big thing. So this is what it's about, and it's a glimpse into me trying to make sense of intersubjectivity in early modern philosophy. So it's on Spinoza and the division of cognitive labor. Now, imagine that you were a student again. You probably remember that moment when you thought that you had this very original idea, and you were quite happy with it. So imagine that you're having such an idea now. It may be just any old idea, say the interpretation of a difficult passage, the solution to a problem. But then you wonder, where did the idea come from? You begin to see that your idea goes back to an inspiration in that book you put down last night. Somewhat disappointed, you doubt that you are as original as you thought. You realize that you had just drawn now to conclusion from something you've read in that book. In fact, it was merely a kind of reformulation of what you read. This happens, to me at least, all the time. In fact, most, if not all things, we think, I think, come from somewhere. Our ideas happen to have a causal story. But if that is true, what is the epistemic status of these ideas? Your birthday, for instance, is something you assume to know quite well. But in fact, you only know it because someone told you so. For much of our knowledge, then, we seem to rely on others. Now, if you think about the way minds work, there are two ways, at least two ways, let's say, to go about this. You can go the Cartesian way. I say Cartesian, not the way Descartes went, so. You can go the Cartesian way and think that you should call all the beliefs that you have into question. To build up knowledge, you have to start from scratch. That's an individualist or subjectivist position, one might say. But you could also go the Spinozist way and acknowledge that everything we know is founded. That's my way of putting this, my reformulation of what I read in the Ethics, perhaps, founded on a division of cognitive labor. A division of labor is grounded in the fact that we can do things together that you and I cannot do alone. Procreation is an obvious example. But if you think about the way our institutions work, you quickly realize that the same is true of cognitive activity. Spinoza's point is then not to step out of this division of labor like Descartes seems to suggest at the beginning of the Meditations, for instance, but to find out how this division works and to make sure that the division is set up in a good way. Coming back to the initial example, then, this would mean to understand that you simply have forgotten your source of inspiration. You can consider your idea and see whether it agrees or disagrees with other beliefs you hold. Rather than pretending to push it aside as the thought of a stranger, you can appropriate it accordingly. And in keeping with that example, I would like to argue that Spinoza's theory of ideas should be understood as suggesting that kind of division of labor. Well, Spinoza's view of the mind has been mainly interpreted as if he were an individualist. I want to convince you that Spinoza starts out from an intersubjectivist or interactionist perspective. Now, what does it mean to defend such a view? I think the basic assumption of such a view is that our minds do not cognize things prior to our relation to others. This means that the content of our thoughts is determined by our mind's relation to other minds. So I will begin by giving an account of the what I call the standard reading, and then in the second step you can follow this basically on the handout, which gives a few passages and the structure of the paper, and contrast this with the interactionist reading. And then I'll discuss thirdly an objection against my reading, and fourthly conclude that I am, sorry, that we are, of course, right. So, that brings me to the first point, the standard reading, holism. So let's begin with some sunshine. What do you actually think when you believe that the sun is shining? Or in Spinoza's terminology, that you have the idea that the sun is shining. A straightforward answer would be that you think of a thing, the sun, and a certain property of that thing, namely that it shines. The thought then would consist in predicating that property of the thing by mentally saying something like, the sun is shining. On this view, which is fairly widespread in the Aristotelian tradition, an idea or thought represents an object that is a kind of thing or state of affairs. Moreover, it represents the object in virtue of the cognitive relation between the idea and the object. This view of intentionality can be called atomistic in that it highlights the idea-object relation. The idea, more precisely its content, is determined by the relation to the represented object. Now, holism opposes this view by focusing on the idea-idea relation. The thought that the sun is shining is determined by other ideas rather than the object. As I will show now, hopefully, Spinoza is seen as a holist who highlights this idea-idea relation. But I'm not giving you any news with that, I suppose. Ultimately, however, I will argue that the idea-idea relation does not only involve ideas in one mind, but also ideas in other minds. And this is what will make Spinoza's holism an intersubjective one. But let's first look at the holism as such. So the first thing to note is that Spinoza endorses a kind of, as Michael Della Rocca called it, a content holism. This means that the content of an idea depends on the content of other ideas. So you cannot have one idea without having many other ideas. Accordingly, you cannot have the idea that the sun is shining without having some ideas that specify what the sun actually is, such as that the sun produces light and heat, that it is a celestial body, etc. Ideas, then, have to be seen as embedded in a network of other ideas. Now, this content holism is often spelled out in relation to Spinoza's thesis of content duality. This is sort of sketched or hinted at in this sketch on the handout. If it helps you to think along, then look at it. I won't go into detail, but it might be there to come back in the discussion. So, content duality, that's also spelled out in text one. If you have the idea that the sun shines, this idea primarily indicates your own bodily state as affected by the sun, while the sun itself is only represented secondarily. We have two relations, one to your bodily state and only secondarily, your idea represents the sun, as it were, itself. Now, this thesis is not outlandish. In cognizing the sun, you primarily grasp its light and warmth, But these are precisely ways in which your body is affected by the sun, not necessarily properties of the sun itself. In this sense, your idea primarily represents your own bodily states. The sun itself is also represented, but only secondarily or partly, namely insofar as it affects your body. However, it has to be noted that these representations are confused. Usually we cannot distinguish between the external things and our body. And thus we tend to misattribute our bodily affections to the external things. You might recognize this line of thought from thinking about secondary qualities, basically. But Spinoza doesn't refer to it as that, but it has been read in that way. But if we can only form a partial and inadequate, confused idea of the sun, then the question arises, who might have a complete idea? And this question reveals, of course, a number of difficulties and gave rise to multiple interpretations. Without going into details, we can say that Spinoza endorses, or one good way of making sense of this is to ascribe to Spinoza what is called a parallelism thesis, according to which ideas primarily represent the bodily states that they are parallel to. Thus, my mind represents my body, your mind represents your body, God's mind represents all bodies, since God constitutes the whole of nature. Combining all these theses, we can see that we are dealing with different kinds of minds. Being just part of nature, human and other minds are partial and have mostly inadequate ideas. Any idea in God's mind, on the other hand, will be adequate. This suggests that the different kinds of minds consist of different nets of ideas. God has a complete net of ideas, while we have different, merely partial, nets depending on our different sets of experiences. I have the feeling that whenever I raise my hand, a light flashes. Some mechanism, action at a distance. So, this suggests that these different minds consist... Now, in view of this picture, so we have God on the one hand and our partial minds on the other, Michael Della Rocca and others attribute a further thesis to Spinoza, namely the mind relativity of content. According to this thesis, the content of an idea is relative to the mind that the idea is part of. Since different minds form different holistic systems, as it were, given that we all have different experiences, your idea and my idea of sunshine will be embedded in different sets of ideas that determine the content of the idea sunshine differently. Despite some lingering textual problems, the mind relativity thesis allows for, I think, a good reading of Spinoza's theory of ideas. However, the very assumption of a holism of ideas is still somewhat underdetermined. While I don't want to counter this standard reading directly, I want to urge an aspectual change and argue for an intersubjective reading of this version of holism. So I want to present basically a duck rabbit. So Michael Della Rocca tells you you're dealing with a duck, and I'm going to say it's a rabbit. But after all, we're working from the same picture. So this leads me to number three, Spinoza's belief holism and an interactionist reading of that. So let's begin by looking at how Spinoza defends his position. I do not wish to repeat the analysis that have been given. Rather, I would like to remind you of Spinoza's starting point in his account of human cognition. Spinoza does not only discuss the determination and adequacy of content, he starts from the more general question of why do we think what we think? Already in the appendix to book one of the Ethics, of book one of the Ethics, Spinoza sketches a very clear and unflattering picture of our mental activity, and I'm going to read this out. It's on your handout, text number 2. It will be sufficient here if I take as a foundation what everyone must acknowledge, that all men are born in ignorance of the causes of things, and that they all want to see their own advantage, and are conscious of this appetite. From these assumptions, it follows first that men think themselves free, because they are conscious of their volitions and appetite, and do not think, even in their dreams, of the causes by which they are disposed to wanting and willing, because they are ignorant of those causes. It follows second that men act always on account of an end, namely on account of their advantage, which they want. Hence they seek to know only the final causes of what has been done, and when they have heard them, they are satisfied, because they have no reason to doubt further. But if they cannot hear them from another, nothing remains for them but to turn towards themselves and reflect on the ends by which they are usually determined to do such things. As is evident, perhaps, Spinoza relates our self-preservation drive, our conatus, and our thoughts. What we believe seems to be mainly determined by our desires. A crucial element in this relation is the ignorance-consciousness distinction. We are mostly ignorant of why we think what we think, and how our desire figures in governing our thoughts. This seems to allow for what one might call a set of systematic misascriptions with regard to the antecedents of our conscious thoughts and desires. We always systematically mistake why we think what we think. I might be thinking of an apple for lunch, and I might think that I think that because I have decided that it's time for a lunch break. While in fact, my thought of the apple for lunch was triggered by a cause that I'm ignorant of, perhaps an association or mere hunger. So I might misascribe freely determined intentions or ends to myself, while I am ignorant of the real causes that drive my thoughts and deeds. This means that the reason or causes out of which I assume to act might often differ from the actual causes of my behavior. Thus, Spinoza does not start from the assumption that the holistic view of ideas is at all obvious. Quite the contrary, Spinoza assumes that we are usually not aware of the holistic dependence of our ideas. This is most elegantly captured, I think, in his assertion that most of our ideas are, as he says, like conclusions without premises. In this sense, Spinoza presents his holism as something that has to be established against a very common prejudice. The prejudice that our thoughts are independent from external thoughts, from the thoughts of others. To make this clear, I would like to direct your attention to Spinoza's discussion of what is usually called the mute picture illusion. That's in text 3. As has been indicated already, Spinoza thinks of ideas not in terms of pictures or images, but as mental operations by means of which we affirm or deny something. That is, he thinks of ideas as beliefs. So we don't ever just see or consider the sun. Rather, we always affirm that it exists, at least, or that it shines, or whatever we affirm of the sun. Our minds never just entertain some content, as it were. There's always an attitude towards that content. The content that the sun is shining is either affirmed or denied. And now, with regard to the matter at hand, I'd like to highlight two observations with regard to this notion of belief. First is the context for Spinoza, in which Spinoza develops this idea. I think it's important to note that this understanding of ideas is introduced in the context of the discussion about free will. Spinoza first explains, this is not the resonance of my voice, is it? I was wondering whether it was because of the microphone. Spinoza first explains that there is no such thing as free will. Rather, the mind willing this or that is determined by a cause, which in turn is determined by another, etc. Humans consider themselves free because they are ignorant of the causes that determine them. Free will is, in that sense, an illusion, following from the ignorance of the causes of our actions. Now, the same is, of course, true of ideas, given the parallelism thesis. We might be inclined to consider our ideas pictures that we can freely entertain and choose to affirm or deny. But if this were true, then there would have to be acts of affirmation or denial that do not already involve an idea. But according to Spinoza, such independent acts do not exist. In analogy to Spinoza's argument against free will, we might say that the reason we can still think of ideas as mute pictures is that we are ignorant of the fact that they are already determined by an affirmation or negation. So while we might think that we choose to believe this or that, our ideas are in fact already determined. This brings me to the second observation, which I sort of title, and this for me was an important idea, but for you it might just be obvious, I don't know, but it helped me to think what's going on here. Ideas as memes. It is equally important to note then that will, although not free, is what gives force to our ideas. Affirmation is not mute, but forceful in taking a stance rather than maintaining a distance. In Spinoza's case, this is not just a manner of speaking, but a point that is, I think, deeply rooted in his metaphysics of the Conatus, according to which everything is determined by its striving to persevere in its being. That's somewhat spelled out in text 4. Accordingly, it makes perfect sense to take Spinoza to assume that ideas themselves have a conatus. That is, ideas or beliefs strive for bringing out their conclusions in the minds that they are part of, while diminishing contrary ideas. So the idea of the sun might be said to strive for bringing out entailments regarding its properties and strive for diminishing ideas that exclude its existence. The idea of the sun, insofar as it affects me, will do the same, but to a greater or lesser degree, depending on how much I care to know about the sun. That ideas have a conatus becomes even more plausible if we remember the parallelism thesis, according to which the order of ideas is the same as that of physical bodies parallel to it. Thus we can say that the body parallel to the idea of the sun strives for self-preservation and for the destruction of threatening or contrary bodies. But thinking as much, I wondered what to make of this assumption. I mean, it seems somewhat outlandish to think about ideas like that, independent from a thinker, as it were. Although it might still sound somewhat strange, there is, I think, a helpful analogy in the contemporary philosophy of mind. That ideas have a conatus could be rendered as the assumption of beliefs as a biological category, or in cultural and especially linguistic conventions, as a kind of meme. In this sense, beliefs can be seen as members of reproductive families that get copied. survive by adapting themselves in certain environments and produce offspring. In this spirit, I'd like to quote a contemporary philosopher of mine, Ruth Millikan. She writes, it's also in your handout, second page, similarly, believes that ideas and concepts can be considered memes, handed down by mechanisms that reproduce them fairly accurately. Many of these beliefs and ideas might be false, of course, and may circulate widely for reasons having nothing to do with their practical value or their truth value. On this model, there are more or less apt environments for biological categories and memes to develop and spread. Analogously, we might say that ideas are memes that strive for survival, but encounter more or less apt conditions, depending on the other beliefs that are part of the mind in question. Thus, ideas thrive in some minds, but wither in others. For example, the idea of a circle might spread and increase in a mathematician's mind, but be threatened or not even get any foothold in an infant of 6 months. This is the basic idea I want to get across. If you go with that, then I'm fine. But now for some worries. In many cases, the ideas conatus is not something following from our own essence, but from the essence of external things or other minds. Since I am not the sun, the idea of the sun does not follow from my own essence, but from the essence of an external thing. It is with regard to the striving of ideas, then, that the said interactionism gains real momentum. If I have the idea of the sun, the idea of the sun strives for self-preservation in my mind, but that striving follows from an essence of an external thing, the sun, not from my own essence. And in this sense, the ideas in my mind are literally ideas from other minds. Their striving is at least partly external to mine. Coming back to the meme analogy, then we might assume that my mind might or might not be a good host for the idea of the sun. And thus we might say that the idea of the sun wills something inside my mind. Generally speaking, I'm mostly willed by external ideas. However, if this is correct, then Michael de la Roca's and others' talk of the mind relativity of content might be somewhat misleading. At least if we take it to mean that ideas are relative to an individual mind. The picture that emerges is rather one according to which there is a vast number of individual minds whose ideas constantly interact. And while some of these minds might be said to strive in unison, like our minds do right now, I think, others will be countering one another. And this means that the striving of ideas that make up my mind is at least partly the striving of external minds. Given the quasi-mimetic or quasi-biological interaction of ideas, it might be more apt to speak of a mind relativity of force, if you distinguish between force and content. A given idea might interact well with some minds and find a suitable host there, while it be rejected by others. Thus, what changes relative to the mind is the force with which an idea can develop in a given mind. Of course, this move might sound quite, perhaps, I don't know, revisionary at first, but we can see how these assumptions fall into place if we recollect Spinoza's contention that men think themselves free because they, that was the text I quoted, because they do not think of the causes by which they are disposed to wanting and willing, because they are ignorant of those causes. In view of this diagnosis, it becomes clear that Spinoza's move provides an answer to the question of what drives our thoughts one way rather than another, despite our misguided descriptions. The causes that mostly drive our thoughts are the ideas of others. Now, the striving of ideas is amplified by what could be called the mechanisms of association and imitation. If I am triggered to think of one thing in relation to another, for instance, my mind will memorize the relation and form a habit of thinking of the one thing in the presence of the other. I could illustrate that with many examples, but I think the point might be fairly clear. So I'd rather move on straight to the objection to my proposal, entitled, Where is My Mind? Now, if we grant this view, it seems that we cannot claim any sense of ownership with regard to our mental life. And I think that is quite crucial in making sense of our experience, which is something that Spinoza wants. He wants not only to give us an account of how the mind works, but also capture the what we now would might call the intuitions we have about what it is that makes up our mental life. So, are our minds our mere battlegrounds of ideas with their own strivings? Spinoza's chapter on human bondage does indeed seem to suggest that we are rather slaves than masters in our mental homes. Clearly, the metaphor of slavery does bring out the social or interactive aspect of our cognitive activity. But the worry is that there might be no sense left in which we can reasonably talk about our own minds. At first glance, the Conatus doctrine seems to offer an immediate answer. After all, my mind is a highly complex idea striving for self-preservation. So at least a certain subset of ideas must be said to form my mind, rather than just internalizations of external forces, as it were. Accordingly, Spinoza writes that the mind, as far as it can, strives to imagine those things that increase or aid the body's power of acting. I quoted that? Sorry, I haven't. Anyway. Of course, the mind cannot and often does go wrong in this. Misunderstanding one's own conscious desires as intention is just one case in point. On the other hand, my mind must be getting some things right as long as I survive. For as long as I live, my mind affirms my being to some extent successfully. That just follows from Spinoza's system, as it were. Get it right to some extent as long as I survive. So even if we do not know which ideas exactly constitute our own minds, the Conatus doctrine allows for a systematic place of a self in that sense. However, even if there is such a place, the question remains what it is that lends itself to the sense of ownership that we have in thinking. It can't be satisfactory to think of one's mind merely as a place where ideas execute their various affirmations. It would be quite odd. And I think this worry can be balanced once we look at Spinoza's theory of emotions. Spinoza makes it abundantly clear that we can track ourselves only through interaction. Now, as is well known, Spinoza does not only assume that ideas are beliefs, but also that they are what I like to call thick beliefs, with a reference to Bernard Williams talking of thick concepts, in that they are laden with emotional value judgment. Briefly put, the extent to which the ideas in my mind are, in fact, external ideas is indicated by their degree of activity or passivity. Now, Spinoza writes, text 6, an effect which is called a passion of the mind is a confused idea by which the mind affirms its body, of its body, sorry, a greater or lesser force of existing than before, which when it is given determines the mind to think of this rather than that. I say first that in effect all passion of the mind is a confused idea, for we have shown that the mind is acted on only in so far as it has inadequate or confused ideas. Unquote. Now to adjust a slogan by Hume, our thinking is not a slave of the passions, but a slave of the external ideas in our minds. Our minds are literally acted on, however the emotional facets of ideas track the degree and the quality of the interaction with other humans or things. Thus the complex idea that is our mind strives to track things and people that increase our power of acting. In this sense he writes, that's text 7, of ourselves and of a thing we love, we strive to affirm whatever we imagine to affect ourselves or the loved thing with pleasure, and by contrast to negate whatever we imagine to affect ourselves or the loved thing with sadness. So it's with regard to this emotional tracking that the assumption of a division of cognitive labor might gain some momentum. Since we equally track whether an interaction is cooperative or competitive, and it is in accordance with this tracking that the connection between our minds and other minds and things is increased or decreased. In other words, as integral parts of beliefs, emotions track the glue of our social relations. To pick just one example from Spinoza's discussion in book 3, that's text 8, if we imagine someone to affect with joy a thing we love, we shall be affected with love towards him. If, on the other hand, we imagine him to affect the same thing with sadness, we shall also be affected with hate towards him. Likewise, we might say that this emotional tracking might provide and strive to amplify a sense of ownership of our ideas. That is, our ideas in the sense that they increase our power of acting. Of course, we might get it wrong. We might imagine something to be good for us when in fact it isn't. Anyone who has gone through a diet might recognize this. We think chocolate is good for us and learn that it isn't. But even if we do go wrong, there is a sense of ownership involved in that thinking. Thinking both sorts, you care about yourself. However, the distinction between active and passive emotions, that is, emotions that track things increasing our power of acting and decreasing, has to be seen in line with the conatus, taken as our essence. Passive or negative emotions are part of ideas that are mostly the result of external forces undermining our conatus. Active emotions are part of ideas that follow from our own essence and the dictates of reason. We'll go into that now, but it's so bit spelled out in text 9 and 10. While many of our ideas are inadequate, and in this sense mainly the result of external ideas acting upon our minds, the adequate ideas result from our own essence and from external ideas that are in agreement with our essence, and in this sense, no longer external. To cut a very long story short, we might say that the internal-external boundary is dynamic. Thus, the sense of ownership is subject to change. The more we understand, that is, the more adequate our ideas become, the more we can appropriate facts that we initially deem as external as internal. Imagine that you have a personal preference for sweets and detest bitter drinks. Conventionally understood, swallowing bitter medicine appears as something external and detestable, perhaps, to you. Yet once you understand its beneficial effect on your preservation, it will, perhaps, become your internal reason for action. Seen thus, the medicine is not forced onto you, rather it follows from your conatus and can thus happily be affirmed as an increase of your power of acting. Or so Spinoza might believe. In this sense, I can also internalize ideas that are entailed by my own essence, but which I previously might have thought to be external to myself. Although it is quite impossible to avoid all disagreement with ourselves, there must be quite some interaction that is in agreement with our own nature, even if it cannot follow from our own nature alone. Thus, it is not surprising to see that Spinoza states as much in view of the Dictamina Rationis. So that's text 11. Again, from part two, it follows that we can never bring it about that we require, that we require nothing outside ourselves to preserve our being, nor that we live without having dealings with things outside us. Of these, we can think of none more excellent than those which agree entirely with our nature. For if, for example, two individuals of entirely the same nature are joined to one another, they compose an individual twice as powerful as each one. From this it follows that men who are governed by reason want nothing for themselves which they do not desire for other men. Closing with this, I try to draw some conclusions. As I hope to have shown, or at least alluded to, Spinoza's philosophy of mind is indeed decidedly un-Cartesian in that it starts from the assumption that ideas, to be taken as beliefs, unavoidably arise in interactions. Therefore, all the questions regarding epistemic status are not so much addressed with regard to the objects of thought, but rather with regard to the interactions of minds, more precisely with regard to the question of why minds are populated with such beliefs rather than others. How then do thoughts affect one another, and why do certain beliefs get fixed rather than others? In reply to this question, nowadays often discussed under the heading of belief fixation, Spinoza develops a careful analysis of the semantic, assertive, and conative aspects of ideas, showing how ideas relate in cooperation or competition, and invoking the conatus to trace ways of superficial or conventional, as opposed to true or natural, disagreement or agreement. Crucial in the emerging picture is the assumption that ideas are quasi-mimetic units that develop more or less well in the environment of certain minds rather than others. And this feature carries over seamlessly to groups who might provide more or less environments for certain ideas to develop. In view of the possibility of interactive agreement, the model that emerges is not that of an individual thinker, but more like that of a research team, in which each member might have a different job. Instead of the division of merely linguistic labor, as it was suggested by Putnam and got famous, as it were, we might imagine then a division of cognitive labor. On this view, I might depend quite literally on certain premises someone has. And I might enhance them, or formulate conclusions, or provide confirmation for yet another researcher. Rather than comparing myself to a divine mind, I would see myself as part of a more competitive or more collaborative team. Depending on the kind of group we are, certain ideas might develop more or less well. Returning then to the question of belief fixation, this also explains why we have one set of beliefs rather than another. Especially in dialogical situations, it becomes clear that my mental states depend quite literally on yours. When you remind or distract me and amplify or diminish certain associations, and while my thought gains more momentum when you confirm it, it loses out if you don't. And if it loses out, my mind might be changed. And with these words, I'd like to finish and thank you for your attention.
Why aren't emotions a network of means themselves? Emotions themselves.
Why aren't?
Yeah.
Right. Well, they are. In the sense that, or if emotions are ideas, or put it in another way, ideas are, come packaged with affirmations, emotions. So ideas are where we're basically. Ideas capture the whole of our mental life. So if we talk about emotions, we talk about certain beliefs that are involved in having a certain emotion. I might think about the sun as something pleasant, and that generates a certain state, also a certain bodily state, etc. And that whole package we might call an emotion. And what one might say is that the sun, what happens is that the sun generates certain states inside of me, and in that sense, generates, as it were, in me the sudden me. Does that sort of reply to your question? Or?
Yeah, but you said that emotions somehow individualize my own mind, while ideas do not.
So oh, did I? Did I say that?
Part of the objections which you
answered. So I'm not sure I understand the question. So just let me restate the question and see how far you go along. So you say I present you with two different things. So ideas are interactive and perhaps determined by interaction, and emotions aren't somehow. That's what's come across?
Somehow emotions make the mind your own.
Ah! Yes, not in a metaphysical sense, they don't individualize my mind, but I would say that emotions are responsible or explain why I might have more or less of a sense of ownership. And the reason for that is that, in Spinoza, is that some emotions I have increase my power of acting, they make me feel good about myself, about what it is I'm part of, and others make me feel bad. And that, in the first instance, sort of increases what could be called my power of acting, and in that sense it traces something that I might take to be me. Now I wonder whether question...
You somehow identified ideas and emotions.
Yes.
But I felt somehow that emotions have this individualizing character, but you said nothing about the physical sense. But
yes.
Still they hint to some ownership. While ideas do not.
Not as such. That's the idea that, the thought in Spinoza, that ideas just thought of as some affirmations and denials, whatever, don't do the job of tracking this sense of a self. But if I If I have a thought, if I think, oh, tomorrow the sun will shine, I feel good about this, I realize that, this thought, I mean, it doesn't give me, bestow on me a metaphysical self, but it gives me a sense of ownership, just in the sense that it increases my power of acting. So I feel just stronger, empowered, as one might say today. So, the more that is increased, the more I might have that sense of ownership. But after all, Spinoza might say, of course, that's wholly misleading, because the more you feel like, oh, I am good, you might forget that what in fact is good is the fact that you sort of fit in very well with your environment and there's a lot of agreement. So a sense of ownership in the sense that, yes, there is something increased that is there, but of course there's also the danger that my misleading thoughts about me being an individual independent from others might be increased. I don't know whether that settles your question or deals with it in some way that is...
Thanks.
Okay.
Have you applied this to both adequate and inadequate ideas or only to one of those? So is this about adequate ideas?
Mm-hmm. Sorry, it's what about adequate ideas? I didn't catch the first part.
I was wondering whether you wanted to present something about the adequate ideas, or you're referring to what is also when people have inadequate ideas.
I'm not so much interested, I mean, this plays, of course, a major role, the distinction between adequate and inadequate ideas. But I was not so much interested in what constitutes the difference between adequate and inadequate, because Spinoza is quite clear on this, and he says that, so adequate ideas are those that follow from one's own essence, and inadequate ideas are those that do not. So the reason for that is what has been called the content duality. So if I have an idea, it always also involves some external cause and a state of my body. So like this flashlight involves somehow the camera or thought of the flashlight itself, but also the effect it has on my body. So I see light, have a certain impression, etc. So there's a content duality, there's a camera, and external and internal, and an idea that idea is always inadequate, and that I confuse the external and the internal aspect. Now, an idea that follows from my own essence cannot be confused in that sense, because it doesn't involve anything external, it seems. It can still be related to external things in that it agrees with other things, but so it tracks or captures them as well. So the case of adequate ideas is actually something that is a problem for me, for my account, because I want to say that, okay, Spinoza diagnoses our situation as one where we always interact with others, and that is mostly dependent on the fact that we mostly have inadequate ideas, because only when we have inadequate ideas we seem to interact. When we have adequate ideas, we seem to be all by ourselves, because we only have ideas that follow from our own essence. So, was your question what I do with that problem, or because I haven't addressed that problem? It's something that is.
The question can be developed further in the sense that you are talking about intersubjectivity,
mm-hmm.
and this can be explained through inadequate ideas,
yeah.
Just as you said. But at the same time, what seems to come out from one's own essence
mm-hmm.
would be something that it's not necessarily intersubjective.
Yes, that's the
described
problem.
Described by intersubjectivity,
mm-hmm.
but by a universal property or
yes.
something different.
Yes. So there's a very big argument about what actually adequate ideas are. There are new proposals on the table. Something like Eugene Marshall, for instance, adequate ideas are innate somehow, that makes things worse for me. But so I would be inclined to go your way and say, no, if I have an adequate idea, it is adequate in virtue of representing something unconfusedly, and that also means that it, so typical ideas are ideas of motion and rest. So somehow they don't only track what follows from my essence, but automatically, because we all seem to agree in that we move and rest, they also track others. So I don't see adequate ideas, I want to argue that I don't see adequate ideas as following from our own essence in the sense that they can only follow from my as opposed to your essence, but that there's an intersubjective sense in the assumption that there's agreement. More can be more or less agreement between you and my own nature. So some things that pertain to my essence agree to other things, with me or not, with me knowing it or not knowing it. They just agree. If we're all, as it were, in a community where that is explicit, where that is known, then we would form a community of friends, as Spinoza puts it somewhere, and I think his idea is that, after all, adequate ideas lend themselves to having forming groups with a stronger conatus that would be a true group of forming one individual as a kind of ideal society. But of course, that's a long way away, so it's kind of utopia that he formulates there. But it would depend on the fact that adequate ideas are interpreted in a certain way. So presents one with difficulties. So, but if, yeah, I have to plug in a certain reading of adequate ideas in order to get this going. If I would say, oh, adequate ideas are just innate, then the standard or the best case would be I have only adequate ideas, but then I would be conceived of as an individual without any relations to others. So I can only say so much. But yeah.
Yeah. So on something related to this question,
mm-hmm.
because when you talk about adequate ideas, of course you have two kinds of adequate ideas. Now what you're saying here, I think, works very well with the second kind of knowledge,
mm-hmm.
with common notions. I think that's perfect. But when we get to the third kind of knowledge,
I was trying to say that. Yes.
With intuitive knowledge, it's not clear to me in any sense there is a contextual account of them. Because they follow directly from God, as he's expressed through, well, an attribute. We're talking about that too. So, okay, there's a very small deduction there. And they follow from the essence of God insofar as he's expressed to our mind.
Mm-hmm.
Which means that there is no correlation with other potential human... And of course, using the word subject or insubjectivity is problematic because Spinoza doesn't
use
it. Well, he uses it twice, but it's not... So in this sense, you can still, I think you can still talk about adequate ideas and have your account, but when you get to the third kind, I don't see how, first of all, you can talk about intersubjectivity when, with intuitive knowledge, and then it doesn't, even if you could talk about we have adequate ideas of the third kind of this or that thing or the other thing, of course, it's a problem of interaction between the ideas themselves.
Mm-hmm.
It seems like they're inert in communicating with each other. They're just expressions of the power of God. So there seems to be no link, right? So I really don't see how that would work with the third kind.
Mm-hmm.
If you could explain that.
Yes. I just thought, I mean, standardly, I don't have an answer to this question. I just thought of one. And you know, sometimes you get lucky. I don't know how far it goes, but I just, you know. So, of course, this is a huge problem because, as you might know, I'm Spinoza thinks of three kinds of knowledge, and the third and most eminent way, which is just intuition of individuals or individual essences, there's much debate. That seems to be something that I can achieve alone and necessarily would achieve alone and not in interaction. So what I want to say is, okay, Spinoza also says that this is a very rare case. I mean, he doesn't think that he got as far as having the third kind of knowledge. So what I would like to say perhaps is this. In order to make Spinoza's account intersubjective, I don't want to claim or interactive, which is perhaps less problematic as a term, it doesn't have to go all the way. So you could say something like this. So the for us humans, usual cases, first and second kind of knowledge, so knowledge through images and signs and knowledge through discourse, discursive means, it's something that is intersubjective. But then this might enable us to have a very special kind of knowledge that is not intersubjective anymore. So you could just say this kind of knowledge prepares you to go to a higher ground, as it were. And then it would depend on the question of whether you can have intuitive knowledge without having the other forms of knowledge. So what I want to say, but you know, it's not thought out at all, but what I might say in reply is maybe it doesn't have to go all the way, but you could still see it as essential given the way we are as humans. We interact linguistically, etc. So in the standard cases that we know, I mean, there's very little intuition going on. But that might just be the kind of thing that prepares us to have a very special kind of intuitive knowledge. I don't know whether you see even further problems arising or whether that would give any...
Well, I mean, it depends then if you're saying if the second or the third kind have the same object or they're different ways of seeing mm-hmm. the same thing. Because then, yeah, if there are different ways of seeing the same thing, yeah, I think your account might work. If somehow the object is different, the atom is different, I'm not so sure.
Yes, and it's not clear to me what Spinoza actually claims, as it's very unclear what this third kind of knowledge is, which comes to my rescue to some extent.
I mean, for instance, Gerou has the argument that, for instance, knowledge of attributes, because they're productive powers, cannot be of the second kind. The second kind of just common notions, attributes are not common notions. So then you'd have different objects. So different objects for the different kinds of knowledge.
Yes.
And then, yeah, preparatory is true, but we also already have some sort of third kind of knowledge.
There's
attributes.
Yeah, so there's also this debate whether I think Eugene Marshall, for instance, wants to claim that the third kind of knowledge is knowledge only of essences, individual essences, which is... I don't know who even wants that, but I mean it's very very difficult. So, but the point is well taken. I mean, in order to get this plausibly integrated, I would have to be committed to a certain reading of the third kind of knowledge. But I think this will remain a caveat. But what helped me just now is thinking. I don't have to go all the way with it. I don't have to say, oh, everything is intersubjective. Why say that? Why not say, okay, this might prepare us for some forms of knowledge that are not dependent on interaction. But, yeah.
May I have just suggested an answer to my question? So I'm wondering whether there's a pump priming problem. That is, so to prime the pump, do you know this expression? You know, some pumps you've got to actually get some oil in or get some water in. Okay,
right.
So with a water pump, you've got to get water into the pipe before it will work. And it looks like you've got to get lots of minds going to have an interactionist mind.
Yes.
And so there's a sort of slippery slope argument here. So we take away one mind, we've still got an interactionist model, we take away another one, but at some point, it just ceases to be an interactionist model. So is there a pump priming problem? And if so, picking up your answer to the last question, can you avoid it by saying, well, there is some sort of knowledge which is not interactionist, and that's, you know, an individual would start with that, and we get a few individuals and off you go.
So you would take things upside down in a way that my answer, I was trying to avoid this subjectivity, as it were, on the everyday level or on the sort of common level. You're saying, well, it might solve a problem for you if you...
Yeah. Well, firstly, do you concede there's a pump priming problem?
Mm.
And secondly, is there a way out?
So I would say no, there isn't. There shouldn't be that kind of problem, because to some extent, I mean, Spinoza committedly is explicitly the kind of holist who will say, I mean, the most reality is in the whole, and it's questionable whether finite individuals really exist in the way or to the degree that the whole exists, that God exists. So given this priority of the whole, his starting point seems to be the whole rather than the past. So I wonder whether this problem would arise for him. Do you see a spot where it might arise, or how it might arise for him? Because I see, I mean, normally you would say, okay, we're now in a room, but in order to interact, one has to start. Like, I have to talk, and then you ask a question, and that's how things are going. But without that, without someone starting, an individual, nothing happens. I think the way that Spinoza sets things up in the what's called the physical interlude, for instance, he would be saying that on a metaphysical level, individuals can only be determined as individuals through the interrelations that they have to others. So the ratio of motion and rest, which might be your essence, gets off the ground, gets going when interaction is in place. As an individual, so the primacy of individual versus whole would be always in favor of the whole being there. So I don't think he would think of that as a problem. But I'm not sure that the last word is spoken on this. It's very difficult because if you promote the holism, then you seem to lose the individuals and lose the interaction, and you end up with something that Spinoza was really saw as a threat. The threat that he might be read as an averroist, saying, well, basically there's just one intellect. And the rest is an illusion. I mean, the fact that there are individuals that think, he's very careful of saying, no, please hear me out, don't think that I'm an averroist. So he might have seen the problem more in the fact that he doesn't get individuals out of his picture, or into his picture, rather than the other way around. But,
okay.
Still on the question of this passage from inadequate to adequate knowledge,
oh, yeah.
the various types of knowledge, apparently it does raise questions on the very idea of intersubjectivity, but even if you can maintain it up to the top, as it were, I wonder if this does not raise even more serious problems for the notion of ideas as having canatas themselves, ideas and memes. Since I suppose the passage from one type of knowledge to another is described in Spinoza as a passage of minds governing themselves or coming to be determined by reason rather than imagination, passions. So unless you can talk about some kind of appetite for self-perfection rather than self-preservation in ideas, then you'd have to talk about minds going from one step to the other, I guess, even if they will not be individual, self-determined, autonomous minds,
mm-hmm.
even if relational, it will still be a progress of minds rather than of ideas themselves.
Ah, mm-hmm. And basically you're saying that in that sense you would still have a mind in the sense that a mind contains ideas, and what progress is the mind
yeah.
that has these ideas rather than the ideas themselves.
Yeah,
yeah. Spinoza is very clear, as you know, that about this linguistic issue, that he will say, although he speaks differently at times, he says clearly that the mind is an idea.
Mm-hmm.
So rather than just something that has ideas. So I exploit for my reading this, so that if the mind, if we say that my mind improves, what actually improves is, or is increased is an idea. The idea, for instance, that is my mind. And if you want to describe that mind, you can either say, okay, so in a pedestrian way, you talk about Martin's mind, that contains certain ideas, but you might also say, well, if you look at it metaphysically, we ought to see that this mind is a highly complex idea that interacts with other complex ideas, and if there's an improvement, that might be the case, because there are other ideas in the vicinity, let's say, that interact well or that form a good host for this kind of idea. So.
Well, my mind is an idea that does something to other ideas, affirms or denies them, right? So, my mind is an idea,
mm-hmm.
but this idea does something to other ideas, affirms or denies them.
Well, the idea is an affirmation. It's not that it gets affirmed. It's not something that's there and then it's affirmed. It is an affirmation that is. So your mind is an affirmation of your existence.
Yeah.
Whatever that involves, I mean, that's a very gross way of speaking, but if you sort of analyze the complexities, would involve all sorts of, you know, down to the digestion, I would think, that all of this is affirmed to some extent. I think it's that way of speaking that would retain, on the one hand, the idea that it's really ideas that have a conatus, but of some ideas we speak as minds.
Yeah.
And that happens when we single out ideas that strive in unison, that have certain, that have a functional unison to persevere. But, you know, you might as well say your mind is a complex idea that contains ideas that aren't really your ideas, because they make you sick or something. It's like, the talk of your mind or my mind is highly difficult, because if you think about that, then there are lots of ideas. So I think the more Spinoza's cases would be something like, if you think of the analysis of religious language, for instance, the suspicion. So society as we know it, I mean, confronts us or teaches us from our cradles, as Locke would put it, I mean, with religious gibberish that
mm-hmm.
we grow up with. And that is what our minds affirm. These are not our ideas in a sense, but we pick up these things. And they're sort of alien, this is alien stuff that works in us, like religious beliefs that we never really analyzed, etc., etc. So in that sense, already the idea that is your mind is in some sense an alienation of what your essence is by comparison. So if there is improvement, if there is rejection of certain religious beliefs, etc., then this kind of improvement happens because, yeah, there's an idea that can follow its conatus. Does it?
Yeah, but there seems to be a distinction between, ideas you know, your example with religious prejudice, let's say, mm-hmm. the kind of word is common in the vocabulary, the superstition. This kind of ideas that propagate themselves, like infections is another metaphor used at the time, right? And presumably they do that because of this canaris, that they need, they have this inbuilt tendency to mm-hmm. propagate themselves and win over the battlegrounds that are our minds, right? So that's one type of idea with canaris.
Mm-hmm.
And what happens is, if my mind, which is itself an idea and has its own canaris, etc., but the ideas that are prejudices
mm-hmm.
cannot have, or do they? Cannot have a tendency to perfect themselves and become better agreement with reality. They are by their nature false or falsifying, right? Whereas human minds at least have this possibility of going up the scale of knowledge
mm-hmm.
by doing some kind of battle with infectious ideas.
I see. So Spinoza's easy way out would perhaps be, I mean, basically we were talking about, just like talking to Baconians, I mean, idols of the marketplace, and it's all over the, I think Spinoza at some point even quotes this Baconian phrase of the captus vulgi, etc. So he clearly thinks of that. And I think he would say that superstition, the kinds of superstition that we have, if we free ourselves from them, it's what they turn out to be, after all, is something that doesn't really exist at all, because it doesn't correspond to anything in the first place. It's an illusion, and that illusion needs a sort of host, like host minds or host groups in which they can thrive, that doesn't make the objects of what they are supposedly representations of exist. But you're saying, so there are two, that's the take-home worry for me, is there are two senses of, and they might be different, or I would have to distinguish between two kinds of striving of ideas. So and the question is, what do I say about such idols of the marketplace? Do they also, they might say to the strive, but they strive in a different sense from what we could call my mind. Yes. I mean, the thing again is that there are, in my mind, sort of locally speaking, ideas that strive for preservation without being properly part of my mind in the sense that they would agree with my own essence.
Mm. Mm.
But they would thrive happily if I was in a sort of group of religious, you know, true believers, and then I would, you know, these ideas would really emerge, but I think I have to refine the picture to capture this distinction. But yeah, it's all another point. Yeah, sorry, I don't know whether that really answers the question, but I'm rather trying to find ways of phrasing this that it ends up in unison with what I hope to defend.
Well, just to push this further, what prevents then the mind to be just a place for the bundle of striving ideas? Because I suspect that you still want to preserve some sort of essence of the mind. But in the direction of the means,
mm-hmm.
then we are here, just bundles of striving ideas. In some cases, these ideas, let's say, strive in the same direction and therefore they
mm-hmm.
become more powerful and then they develop in to
yeah.
certain directions, but without this connotation of improvement,
mm-hmm.
they can be completely false. And
yeah.
we are becoming raving lunatics, some of us.
Yeah. yes.
Okay, but then you don't need the essence anymore. You know, to what extent do you want to preserve the essence, and in what way this essence is different from just
yeah.
a bundle, just a name for a bundle of striving ideas?
That That's a very difficult question because I think there are two general interpretations of what essences are for Spinoza in that sense. And there's this eternalist reading where we say it's all fixed, what makes sense. These essences get expressed when we live, but basically it's all settled. And then that would be fairly individualistic to some at some point, because we have sort of all these formulas. You might think of essences as formulas, for instance, but they're all sort of inscribed in the whole, but they are singled out in a way. They are what they are. They are. So you have an essence, your mind has an essence that's fixed for eternity. Your life is an expression of that. But that would make us end up with a completely individualistic picture. There's this other reading of essences where one might say, no, there's not this eternalist view, but essences have to, they have to undergo a process, and this. In a life, so they're not just fixed in a divine mind and then expressed by me, for instance. I express my essence to some extent, and then I die and whatever, but this essence remains in place. But that my life is part of that essence. So this would be another reading. And then the idea would be that there are no essence separate from the individuals that we take ourselves to be, but these essences become through interactions and through the lives we live, and they would be part our lives would be part of realizing this essence. So on the one picture you have a divine mind, and there you have individual essences fixed, then you have for some duration you have the realization of that, and even if that ceases to exist, it's still in the divine mind. So this would be the this kind of eternalist reading. Is that what you have in mind?
My question was, in whichever way you are interpreting what essences are, the question was, what is the relation between all this bundle of striving ideas, of these conatus-based bundles, and the essence? Is the essence more like a matrix where this is happening, or is the essence a meta-idea of a different kind than the striving ideas that can be true or false, or how do you preserve both the essence and the striving ideas?
So I would say if that's an individual, my mind, it has a certain ratio of motion and rest, and this ratio is also expressed by certain ideas, and these ideas are its essence. But they are not as such, but they are, they, as it were, get off the ground by being part of, being related others. So to put it simply, perhaps, I have a conatus. The conatus is my essence. That's my will, my drive to persevere. But this drive can only get off the ground if there is something I have to strive for, or I have to sort of work against. If there's nothing. If I was like God, it wouldn't make sense to speak of a conatus, and in that sense, it wouldn't make sense to speak of the essence of a finite mode.
Good, but what prevents this conatus sum of the striving Conrad perceives of ideas that are coming false or true or whatever,
mm-hmm.
that are coming from the outside world. And then you are just in the bundle description
yeah.
of properties. Or
yes.
Synopsis.
I think I can, I thought I could embrace that picture
mm-hmm.
and say that we are just, I mean, there's a huge bundle, God, and some parts in this bundle strive in unison for the same ends. And
mm-hmm.
These then form like individual trees, humans, etc. Because they form functional units for a certain duration. And insofar as they form this unit, they can rightly be said to express an essence. But
I think Dana's, can I interrupt?
Yeah.
I think Dana's question is in a way that in the moment you're thinking about this bundle with parts, the parts are quite ad hoc. So you have a way of individuating at the level of the extension and at the level of thought. That's it. Everything else is quite random. So I am what I am because of a randomness
mm-hmm.
which could have been otherwise, but then nobody can tell me that I am what I am because you might slice me up as if I am, whereas someone else can remove an idea from me and then say, well, no, without this idea, it's what you are.
Ah.
So there's a problem when you start trying to say,
mm.
my mind is this matrix of whatever sort of connections of other ideas, you have a problem. You either go further and say, there's no identity of mine at this level, and that's the discussion. We're ending up here. We just have ideas bundled
yeah.
together, and that's fine, but you don't bring in my mind versus Dana's mind versus Doina's mind
yes.
and so on and so forth. Because you don't have a way of a principled way of individuating them. Everything ends up being ad hoc.
I see. So if I embrace the picture I just claim to embrace, I end up with a sort of random that can't
the
be really Spinozist.
It was described in the conversation
yeah.
suggested that, which I don't think is a big problem. I think actually it's fine. I mean, so when you have the metaphysical picture that Spinoza has, that's okay. You don't need to have a sense, a very well-determined sense of the self because you never begin with the individual. So you just begin with a metaphysical picture and
mm-hmm.
you just get the metaphysical picture and that's fine. That's what
yeah.
you get. If you want to have a practical picture, you'll just have to have a different philosophy. That's
yes, yes.
Something else.
That if you agree, can I? Do you agree?
Yeah.
Because it wasn't. That's very very helpful. Of course, also that you say that it's not a problem, but I still what I want to retain and what I might get. Run into problems again with is if I want to say okay this is a let's say this is a certain unit, this is me, and you want to say no, but if you really think about it, this is not part of you.
But I mean, you can read it. I think if you take it like Jonathan Schaffer,
mm-hmm.
right, and you just go and say, look, everything is, it's about grounding relations.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not really about the entities that are at every single level, because for every single level, we will have different methodologies with which we will go about investigating
mm-hmm.
them. We just offer a picture of grounding relation. And in this picture of grounding relations, we have this story about ideas at one level that can never kind of be then put back together with the level of the individuals.
Mm-hmm.
And that's okay. So, and that's actually favoring the interactionist reading, right? Because that interactionist
yeah.
reading goes off the ground immediately because everything you have is ideas that are striving for themselves, not for my own identity as having those ideas.
You give a stronger defense now of my reading than I have myself. And I'm reluctant to embrace it for the moment because I somehow want to be able to say still, like, I might say bananas are good for you because you are the way you are, right? And for instance, and that's to do with your essence. You might think they're no good for you for some other reason, but if I want to say that, I have to, of course, retain some robust level.
Couldn't you think about this as different levels of analysis? I mean, I have no idea. I don't understand Spinoza. I never did. You know, I think I would ever will. But maybe rather than thinking, okay, we need a system that hands stays together at all levels, we might actually have different levels at which, you know, we can account for these things. And if we talk about ideas and ideas striving in an interactionist mm-hmm. picture, we cannot just bring back in the individual as a self whose identity needs to be pinned down by a particular bundle of ideas, because unless he has a very principled way of giving you this, which might be with the emotion story, I don't know,
yeah.
It might be that through emotions you can get something, that's fine. If you don't get that, then...
That would be certainly a way to go. But, that's really enhancing the idea. When I hear levels is, of course, is something that makes me worry, because someone like, you know, I give the next paper and then I say, Laura said, let's think of this in terms of levels of analysis, and then Michael Della Rocca, for instance, says, yeah, but then you introduce the notion of level of analysis and you need to make a distinction between those levels, and what does give you this distinction? What accounts for it? Isn't that as random as... wouldn't that be a random distinction?
I would say yes, it is, and that's fine. I mean, because it's going to be random relative to some specific purposes, right? It's not quite random. Random is going to be relative to the purpose of your...
Do
with it.
And can you find it in the doctrine of ideas of ideas? Clearly there's a parallelism there.
Yes.
That's grounded in the text.
Absolutely. Now you convince me quite already. I have to think about that. No, that's wonderful. It's just that I still feel worries, and the worries are quite, you know, the kind of thing like, oh, you seem to want a robust sense of something essential.
Is there a principled way of defining why my body is my body in Spinoza?
No.
Well, why should there be then one for the mind? That would be the next question. If I don't have one for my body as my body, then, you know, this atom separating me from the environment, why do I have to have one at the level of the...
The word that probably worries me is random, but if you give the story of, okay, random is relative to a certain purpose and we don't read randomness too cool, then I could be fine.
But I mean, it's going to be depending on whatever the striving is. I mean, there has to be a story about the striving for something.
Yeah, yeah.
And maybe there you can get something.
But okay, well, then we get into all sorts of troubles relating to knowledge, okay? So there are ideas in this room
mm-hmm.
that are striving. Let's say that they have, the purpose is to clarify the conclusion of your talk. That's the global purpose to which we all strive right now, or our ideas are striving.
So it sounds, yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and some are discarded as being false, some are going in consensus, and some are going against each other. So it cannot be just a mathematical, arithmetical sum in terms of, you know, the sum of motions.
Mm-hmm.
Somewhere there should be a more complex structure that allow the clarification, let's say,
mm-hmm.
or the, you were saying at some, you were talking at some point, in terms of spelling out the conclusion or spelling out
mm-hmm.
the implication of a particular idea that proves to be, I don't know, more forceful, have a larger speed. So.
But you can have a pragmatic reading of what's going on, right? And you just can say, well, the purpose of the clarification of this just requires me to make a statement about Spinoza's metaphysics. Here are the ideas that have helped me to in that direction. Here are the ideas that I'm discarding away. And then, I mean, because if I understand, again, and I don't understand Spinoza, but if I were to a bit kind of try and understand what he's saying, this is how he views science. For him, science is not a final discoverer of the truth. It's nothing of that sort. It's just a mechanism through which, at the end of the day, you get an inadequate
mm-hmm.
picture of knowledge. And it's, you're going to understand it, I guess, a bit more through pragmatical means.
Mm-hmm.
And that might in a way help. So you don't get a final, like, you will not get a final clarification.
No, I didn't mean that you get a final clarification. I just meant that some of the ideas get discarded and they cannot strive anymore. They are kind of defeated and disappear from the bundle.
be that the global bundle of us here or the individual bundle, Laura and Dana, you know.
So let's say that you have, I mean, I don't know how I see this. So let's say you want to make a distinction between prejudiced ideas and non-prejudiced. And for Spinoza, it will end up being the story about, well, actually, no idea is in itself prejudiced or non-prejudiced.
Yeah.
It's going to become prejudiced or non-prejudiced relative to a particular contextual understanding. So that's a way in which a particular question that we raised is going to be clarified in the, do you see how the thing is? So it's all the time relative to some specific end of the action that you're gonna.
Yes.
That's how I think it will
and
go.
That's
all there is to it.
There is this kind of the global prevails towards the individual, even in the definition of the ends.
Well, I guess the at the end he will have to have something like so this that's the doctrine of the canatus somehow will have to be so there has to be a more substantial understanding of what self-preservation is, which to be honest it's not, because if you have a problem with identifying the individual, I am not striving for my own self-preservation. There's something more general that strives for its own self-preservation, unless you have some understanding of here is the universal good, or here is, if you don't have something that can like coherently explain to you how this canatus might work, then you will just have to have a pragmatic analysis of the canatus at the end as well. So, and I don't know if Spinoza has something like this, because I don't understand what he's doing.
No, I mean that seems right. That the conatus is something that is determined, you know, in virtue of its striving, not the other way. It's not determined by striving for something in particular or for some general good. Whatever might turn out to be good is the good that it strives for, and but it's this perseverance, if it makes any sense. Would be the good, but that can be cashed out in so many ways, depending on how you construe the individual and that strives, what it consists of. You might say this individual, this group, strives to persevere, which might mean that we all talk forever, and no one's sort of thinking of their individual food.
Here is where
desires.
I think things don't add up. I think that the sort of translating the doctrine of the conatus then back to this particular situation, like we discussing something, striving for, it seems wrong to me. I don't know why. I feel that that's why I'm saying that maybe in Spinoza there's a way in which you can disentangle the metaphysical stories from everything else. And, you know, maybe you need the metaphysics as a way of grounding some ethical project, some political project, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
But maybe you want to disentangle it, because the moment you're trying to think metaphysically about non-metaphysical stuff, it just gets very messy. And it shouldn't be this messy.
Mm-hmm.
And it seems coherent with, he's okay with science. He likes to talk about experiments, although, you know, from a metaphysical point of view, or from the point of view of what it takes knowledge to be, scientific knowledge is kind of useless.
Yeah.
So you just take different, I mean, maybe if you're that other kind, you want some sort of hardcore principle of intelligibility of the world, then that's it.
Yeah. What I take home from Michael Della Rocca is if you introduce distinctions between levels or whatever, then you have to have some reason to account for them, and you better have some, because Spinoza wouldn't just say, oh, it's a brute fact that, you know, at some levels there are ideas and it makes sense to talk of them, and at another they don't count. There has to be a reason. So that kind of randomness is a bit worrying, but on the other hand, I see the advantage of your proposal, because it gives me a way of responding to the.
It's not my proposal. It's just a kind of I'm just
an idea striving to
sort of thing that we were discussing that kind of. I mean, what I my own view in this is that it's not a big cost. I feel that for Spinoza, it's not a big cost to say I don't have an identity of my own mm-hmm. that I can define through the set of ideas or the bundle of ideas that compose me. That's mm-hmm. there's something as if there is no sense in which I need to like bring back my mind mm-hmm. as a separate, because in a very substantial sense, yes, ideas are exactly this, are these sort of weird things that strive mm-hmm. for themselves in a weird
yes.
realm, or platonic. No, I was...
Yeah. I don't know whether I should be the judge of this or whether I, you know, it's... I'm quite impressed with this discussion because it brings out, I think, a problem. So, and it seems like I can't have my cake and eat it. And either I embrace this kind of randomness or try to figure out a way. But that means I can't retain the sense of, like, of telling an individual, like, this is... So you think this is good for you, but in fact it turns out, looking at your essence, this is no good for you. And all this depends on things that you don't know, that you ignore, because you ignore the causes that determine you, blah, blah, blah.
I don't know, so this idea of being good for you, right? How do you articulate that in a metaphysics where you have a parallelism, but at the same time a disjunction between my body and my mind? Mm-hmm. Like, how would you make sense of what it means? Like, even the sort of story about the banana. Is the banana good for me or is the banana bad for me?
Mm-hmm.
Like, how do you make sense of that in Spinoza's terms? Like, this is genuinely me. I'm not understanding anything.
Would make sense. I mean, what I just think of is maybe it would make sense to introduce this level talk where Spinoza says, so we can... What we call an individual is a matter of consideration. So we can call us an individual, you can call me an individual, or my right finger, whatever. It's a matter of consideration. And at that point you can say, so at certain levels, you get certain pragmatic constants that weigh with, if you have this level of individual talk, then banana's figure. If not, they
don't. You're not being very, I mean, it's a very nice version of pluralism. I don't really see the problem with it, right? Because you can say, look, I'm okay with introducing the level of the atoms,
mm-hmm.
and I'm also okay with introducing a level of something that is not, you know, I'm not embracing atoms, I'm just embracing atoms for a particular physics,
mm-hmm.
whereas for a particular thing like biology, I'm embracing entities like an organism. And he would say, well, yeah, you can do that. Of course, you can do that because this is anyway just that sort of what primer first, the first form of knowledge, second, I can't remember.
Yeah.
But, you know, so it's not really the high stake in doing that. So why not go that route?
Just like conceptual schemes layered onto one another and at certain levels. You have bananas and others.
Yeah, and you can just metaphysically, you can talk
yeah.
about, I mean, this is just reading it through Schaffer, right? You can just talk
mm-hmm.
about grounding relation, and you just say, yes, they are grounded on this very basic metaphysical
mm-hmm.
level, but that does not mean that metaphysical level can in any way account for all the properties that are sort of like brought about at these higher levels, which
yes.
are brought about through means of considerations, as you call them.
I think you might be in unison with Ursula Renz there, who thinks of the whole first part of the ethics as a metaphysical framework that doesn't automatically underpin
yeah.
what's coming later. Yes.
Well,
what do you think about moving this discussion next door around a glass of something, because it's kind of 8 o'clock. So
I can only thank you very much.
Thank you.
For